Because what the Islamic State group wants to destroy, well, we want to protect it.
The shelves are now filled with 8 centuries worth of rare testimonies of the history and culture of the region. Generations of Dominicans have risked their lives to transfer some 3,500 works here.
Our manuscripts and archives are just like nomads from the desert. We brought all these documents on camelbacks. We used donkeys. They traveled on caravans. And that's why these pages have an even deeper historical meaning. They really are treasures.
The Dominican motto is to contemplate and to transmit to others the fruit of contemplation. Father Najib's predecessors had to copy everything by hand.
Everything that is written, whether it's Christian or non-Christian, scientific, astrological, or medical, has been digitized. Even the tiniest bit of paper gets a reference code. Everything is digitized so that it can be preserved forever.
8,000 manuscripts have been digitized in the last 25 years. Half of the originals have now been destroyed by the Islamic State group. The National Archives in Paris have simultaneously been reviving them.
For the past 25 years, I've been digitizing historical documents in the shadows. And now all this is being exposed in broad daylight, so to speak, by the National Archives, so that they can be seen by everyone. Nowadays, it's become very important to speak of mankind rather than religions. Culture and knowledge have often been like a crossroad for humanity, a place where things can converge, where people can share things and live together despite their differences.
Islamic State militants have reportedly burnt more than 100,000 manuscripts in Mosul. Artifacts at hundreds of sites in Syria and Iraq remain under threat.
Diamond realized that Yali's question was far bigger and more complex than it first appeared. It was really about the roots of inequality. A question as old as human history itself.
Why, since ancient times, have some societies progressed faster than others? What allowed the Egyptians to build great pyramids while most of the world was still scratching out a living? How did the Greeks ever develop such an advanced civilization? Or the Romans, or the Maya. All great civilizations have had some things in common: advanced technology, large populations, and a well-organized workforce. If I could understand how those things came into existence, then I'd understand why some people march faster than others during the course of history.
Diamond set out to explore the division of the world into haves and have-nots. It was a massive challenge that few scholars would have dared take on. He was a scientist, not a historian. How could he possibly solve the great puzzles of human history? To understand where inequality came from, Diamond needed to identify a time before inequality, when people across the world were living more or less the same way. He had to turn back the clock thousands of years, back before the first civilizations, back into prehistory. Years ago, the ravages of the last ice age were over. The world was becoming warmer and wetter. One area where humans were thriving was the Middle East. Thirteen thousand years ago, the Middle East was far less arid than today, with more forests, trees, and plants. People here lived like people everywhere at this time, as hunter-gatherers in small, mobile groups. They were frequently on the move, making shelters wherever they could find animals to hunt or plants to gather. They'd live in these shelters for weeks or months at a time, as long as they could keep feeding themselves. But as seasons changed and animals migrated, they'd move on to the next valley or ridge looking for new sources of food. In the Middle East, there were very different plants to gather. Growing wild between the trees were two cereal grasses, barley and wheat, far more plentiful and nutritious than sago. These simple grasses would have a profound impact, setting humanity on a course towards modern civilization. But it would take a catastrophic change in the climate before this would happen. Twelve and a half thousand years ago, the world's climate became highly volatile. The long-term thaw that had brought about the end of the last ice age suddenly went into reverse. Global temperatures dropped, and ice age conditions returned. The world became colder and drier. The Middle East suffered an environmental collapse. Animal herds died off. So did many trees and plants. The drought lasted for more than a thousand years. People were forced to travel farther and look much harder to find any source of food. But despite the conditions, they would somehow survive and even prosper. Here in the Middle East, a new way of life would come into being, one that would change the face of the earth. Ian Kite is a Canadian archaeologist who specializes in the Stone Age history of the Middle East. His work is focused on a site in the Jordan Valley near the Dead Sea, a place known as Dra. Kite is a co-director of the dig and works with an international team of archaeologists. They've uncovered the remains of ancient dwellings that were clearly more sophisticated than any hunter-gatherer shelters. They believe this was a small village, one of the earliest permanent villages anywhere in the world. People were starting to put down roots.
What we would have had was this village of, I don't know, 40 to 50 people living in the same place. We would have had a series of oval huts that would have been partially cut into the ground. And these would have been very much the first time people settled down and lived in communities in a really extensive way.
When they radiocarbon dated the site, they discovered that the village first emerged 11 and a half thousand years ago, at the same time as the end of the drought in the Middle East. But how was it possible to feed an entire village if times were so hard? After 4 years of digging at Dra, the archaeologists believe they have an answer. It lies in this unique structure.
What you can see here is the outline of a mud wall coming all the way around here. And in the inside we have a series of upright stones that have been chipped in such a way where you can see a notch on them. And there would have been a series of beams over top of that with a floor across it. And basically you would have had a dry, humidity-controlled environment where they could take grain, they could take any plants, they could dry them out, put them in here, protect them from insects, protect them from moisture, protect them from water percolating through. What that ends up being, from our perspective, is probably the world's first granary in some form, a place where they're able to store food in a particular location on a year-round basis.
The team at Dra believes the granary was an oval-shaped mud wall building at the center of the village, a place where grain could be stored collectively. And the grains that were being stored were primarily wheat and barley. While other plants were no longer available, these cereal grasses were hardy enough to survive and durable enough to be stored for years. But if this was a time of scarcity, how was there enough grain to fill a granary? The answer suggests a radical shift in human behavior. At some point during the drought in the Middle East, people started growing their own food. Unable to maintain a mobile way of life, they would have stayed close to any source of water they could find and planted new fields of wheat and barley around them.
Rather than just following food sources around different locations, for the first time what people start to do is that they bring these resources back to them. Not just as harvested food, but they're bringing them as seeds. And they're growing them next to their village. And that's the first time, really, this is the first time we see this anywhere in the world.
The Stone Age people of the Middle East were becoming farmers. The first farmers in the world. Without realizing it, these new farmers were changing the very nature of the crops around them. With every round of planting and harvesting, they'd favor ears of wheat and barley whose seeds were the biggest, tastiest, or easiest to harvest. Traits that were useless to the plant in the wild thrived under human cultivation.
They interrupted the cycle. They interrupted the normal environmental cycle and started to select these individual plants and basically rewarding those that were going to be most profitable to them. And so even though it was accidental, once that whole process started, people are starting to control nature.
The way crops are changed by human interference is known as domestication. Today it happens in research labs, with scientists selecting genes and breeding crops to be ever more useful to humans. It's a very precise, deliberate process, but not so different from what the first farmers were doing unconsciously thousands of years ago in the Middle East. By 9,000 years ago, the first settlements in the Middle East were giving way to much larger villages. People were only able to live on this scale by becoming more productive farmers. They were surrounded by fields of domesticated wheat and barley. But by now, they also had another steady source of food.
What we see happening about 9,000 years ago is a remarkable transformation in the way that humans are interacting with animals. We begin to see a process of animal domestication, by which we mean humans were controlling where they were moving, they were controlling their feeding, and they were controlling their breeding. Instead of having to go out to hunt, you have a dependable meat supply on the hoof year-round around your site, rather than being subject to seasonal variations in wild game.
As well as meat, animals could be used for their milk, providing an ongoing source of protein. Their hair and skins could be used to make clothes for extra warmth. Over time, domestic animals became an integral part of the new agricultural way of life.
We know that the communities which first started to have domestic animals already had cereal crops, so they were cultivators. And the combination of these particular animals and the plants becomes an extremely attractive package in that they're complementary. After the harvest period, animals could be turned out on the stubble and they can actually eat the remains of the cereal crop harvest. In their turn, animal dung can be used to provide sort of a fertilizer for the cereal crops as well, for crops. So the whole package, you know, is seen to be mutually beneficial, both for the animals and the plants, and of course for the humans.
Goats and sheep were the first animals to be domesticated in the ancient world, and were eventually followed by the other big farm animals of today. All of them were used at first for their meat, but they all proved useful in other ways, especially with the invention of the plow. Before the Industrial Revolution, beasts of burden were the most powerful machines on the planet. A horse or an ox harnessed to a plow could transform the productivity of the land, allowing farmers to grow more food and feed more people. In New Guinea and many other parts of the world, people never used plows because they never had the animals to pull them.
The only big domestic animal in New Guinea was the pig, and wasn't even native. It came in from Asia a few thousand years ago. While Europe and Asia had not only pigs, but also cows, sheep, goats, horses, buffalo, camels, and so on. Now, pigs do give you meat, but pigs don't give you the other products that you get from those European nation animals. Pigs don't give you milk, or wool, or leather, or hides. Most important of all, pigs can't be used for muscle power. Pigs don't pull plows or pull carts. The only muscle power in New Guinea was human muscle power. Even today, there are no beasts of burden in New Guinea, and almost all of the farm work is still done by hand. But if farm animals were so useful, why didn't New Guineans domesticate any of their own? I decided to add up all the animals in the world that have ever been domesticated. And I was amazed by what I found.
There are nearly 2 million known species of wild animals, but the vast majority have never been farmed. Most insects and rodents are of no practical use to humans, and not worth the effort of farming. Some birds, fish, and reptiles have been domesticated, but most are simply impractical to farm. So are most carnivores, not because they're dangerous, but because you'd have to grow other animals just to feed them. The best animals to farm are large, plant-eating mammals. And over the years, humans have probably tried to domesticate all of them, usually without success. Despite repeated efforts, Africans have never domesticated the elephant. In South Asia, some elephants are used as work animals. But they're not farmed for the purpose. Instead, each elephant is caught in the wild and then tamed and trained. It doesn't make economic sense to farm an animal that takes some 15 years to mature and reach an age where it can start reproducing.
Animals which make suitable candidates for domestication can start giving birth in their first or second years. They will have one or maybe two offspring a year, so their productivity is actually high. Behaviorally, they need to be social animals, meaning that the males and the females and the young all live together as a group, and they also have an internal social hierarchy, which means that if humans can control the leader, then they will also gain control over a whole herd or a whole flock.
There is another crucial requirement for a domestic animal. It needs to get along with humans. Some animals don't have the temperament to live on a farm. A zebra could be an ideal domestic animal, potentially as useful as a horse. But evolving in the midst of Africa's great predators, zebras have become flighty, nervous creatures. They have a vicious streak that humans have been unable to tame. That may be why zebras have never been harnessed to a plow or ridden into battle.
I counted up 148 different species of wild, plant-eating, terrestrial mammals that weigh over 100 pounds. But of those 148, the number that have ever been successfully farmed for any length of time is just 14. Goats, sheep, pigs, cows, horses, donkeys, Bactrian camels, Arabian camels, water buffalo, llamas, reindeer, yaks, mithans, and bally cattle. Just 14 large domestic animals in 10,000 years of domestication. And where did the ancestors of these animals come from? None was from New Guinea, or Australia, or Sub-Saharan Africa, or the whole continent of North America. South America had the ancestor of just one large domestic animal, the llama. The other 13 were all from Asia, North Africa, and Europe. And of these, the big four livestock animals, cows, pigs, sheep, and goats, were native to the Middle East. The very same area that was home to some of the best crops in the world was also home to some of the best animals. Little wonder that this area became known as the Fertile Crescent.
The people of the Fertile Crescent were geographically blessed. with access to some of the best crops and farm animals in the ancient world. It gave them a huge head start. What had begun with the sowing of wheat and the penning of goats was leading towards the first human civilization. The archaeological site of Gwer in southern Jordan is 9,000 years old. But it has all the hallmarks of a town. A few hundred people lived here in rows of houses that were a wonder of technology.
Every time I come here, I'm amazed by what those people were doing. Some of the houses have a kind of air conditioning. This window here is to control the air coming from the street inside the house. And the houses, the walls and the floors of the houses from the inside at least, were covered with plaster. So people were moving to the concept of homes. It's not a place just to sleep. It is a proper home, and people started to decorate the houses from the inside. And people were started to invest in their homes, because if we are talking about plaster, it is time consuming, it's effort consuming. It's very expensive to have a plastered house.
As villages grew bigger, there were more people to work on the land. More people could produce more food more efficiently, enough to support specialists within the community. Freed from the burden of farming, some people were able to develop new skills and new technologies. Making plaster from limestone was a major technological breakthrough. The stones had to be heated for days at a time, at a temperature of 1,000 degrees. It may seem insignificant today, but understanding how to work with fire was the first step towards forging steel, a technology that would transform the world. Yet for all its advantages, the Fertile Crescent is not the powerhouse of the modern world, nor is it the breadbasket it once was. How did it lose its head start? Within 1,000 years of their emergence, most of the new villages of the Fertile Crescent were abandoned. Ironically, the region had a fundamental weakness. Despite having some of the most nutritious crops on the planet, its climate was too dry and its ecology too fragile to support continuous intensive farming.
People were destroying the environment. The waters had been overexploited, the trees had been cut, and this is what when you face a dead end. I mean, you are facing the wall. You will end with landscape like that. I mean, with few trees, with no grass, and with less water. So what we are looking at today is the outcome of overexploiting the environment.
Unable to farm their land, entire communities were forced to move on. The advantages they'd accrued from centuries of domestication might have been lost. But again, geography was on their side.
The Fertile Crescent is in the middle of a huge landmass, Eurasia. There were plenty of places for farming to spread. And crucially, many of those places were to the east and west of the Fertile Crescent at roughly the same line of latitude. Why is that so important? Because any two points of the globe that share the same latitude automatically share the same length of day, and they often share a similar climate and vegetation. Crops or animals domesticated in the Fertile Crescent were able to prosper at other places along the east-west axis of Eurasia. Wheat and barley, sheep and goats, cows and pigs all spread from the Fertile Crescent, east towards India and west towards North Africa and Europe. Wherever they went, they transformed human societies.
Once the crops and animals of the Fertile Crescent reached Egypt, they caused an explosion of civilization. Suddenly, there was enough food to feed the pharaohs and generals, the engineers and scribes, and the armies of people required to build the pyramids. The same is true of European civilization. From ancient times until the Renaissance, crops and animals of the Fertile Crescent fed the artists, inventors, and
I wonder the rice fled when he had this to come back to.
One for every night of the year. How will I ever go back to Lysimachia after this?
I advise you not to touch the nettles here. I'll take care of it for you.
Aristotle was perhaps prescient. Do these images fool us with their beauty and degrade our souls?
Great King Alexander.
The Princess of the Thousand Roses, and eldest daughter of the formerly great King Darius. Statira.
Noble Alexander. I come beg for the lives of my sisters. My mother, my grandmother.
You are not wrong, Princess Tatira.
He too is Alexander.
Please, I plead for my family's lives. Sell me as a slave, great king. But
look
please,
now.
Do not.
In my eyes. Princess. And tell me, how would you like to be treated?
As I am, a princess.
And so be it. You and your family shall be treated as my family. You shall live in this palace as long as you choose. Have you any other requests for me, my noble princess?
No. Everything I wish I have requested.
You truly are a queen.
Soldiers of Europe. In the 16th century, the same crops and animals were taken by Europeans to the New World. At the time, there was not a single cow or ear of wheat in all the Americas. Now there are 100 million cattle in the US alone. And Americans consume 20 million tons of wheat a year. Modern, industrialized America would be unthinkable without the spread of farming from the Fertile Crescent. There are some who think Jared Diamond's argument is too neat and easy. Can the distribution of wealth and power really be reduced to cattle and wheat? What about culture, politics, and religion? Surely they've been just as important. Diamond's been criticized for being too deterministic, for ignoring the part people have played in shaping their own destiny. Looking back thousands of years, he argues that farming gave some cultures an enormous head start. And those who were lucky enough to have the most productive crops and animals became the most productive farmers. Agriculture first developed in a part of the Middle East known as the Fertile Crescent. Over time, crops and animals from the Fertile Crescent spread into North Africa and Europe, where they triggered an explosion of civilization. By the 16th century, European farms were dominated by livestock animals that had come from the Fertile Crescent. None were native to Europe. They provided more than just meat. They were a source of milk and wool, leather and manure. And crucially, they provided muscle power. Harnessed to a plow, a horse or an ox could transform the productivity of farmland. European farmers were able to grow more food to feed more people, who could then build bigger and more complex societies. In the New World, there were no horses or cattle for farming. all the work had to be done by hand. The only large domestic animal was the llama, but these docile creatures had never been harnessed to a plow. The Incas were very skilled at growing potatoes and corn, but because of their geography, they could never be as productive as European farmers. Horses gave Europeans another massive advantage. They could be ridden. To the Incas, the sight of Pizarro's conquistadors passing through their land is extraordinary. They've never seen people carried by their animals before. Some think they are gods, these strange-looking men, part human, part beast. The horses that seemed so exotic to the Incas had already been used in Spain for 4,000 years. In an age before motorized transport, they allowed people to be mobile and control their land. When Javier Martin is not herding cattle, he gives displays of traditional Spanish horsemanship. This style of riding is known as jineta. The emphasis is on control and maneuverability, using bent knees to grip the sides of the horse and only one hand on the reins. Very different from the more formal style of medieval knights. By the 16th century, the jineta way of riding had become the dominant style of the Spanish cavalry. This is how the conquistadors would have ridden their horses.
It's an amazing display of a big animal being controlled by a person, precise control, stopping and starting and turning. Javier told me that he has been riding since he was 5 years old. And when I watch this, I have a better understanding of where the conquistadors were coming from. They were masters of these techniques, and they learned these techniques for working with bulls, but the techniques were also good in a military context as well. And I can see that this control would let you ride down people in the open. People who had never seen horses before would have been absolutely terrified watching this. It would be strange and frightening, and that's even before one of these animals is rushing towards you, riding you down, about to lance you and kill you.
News of the godlike strangers on their four-legged animals is taken by royal messenger to the emperor of the Incas, who's camped in the valley of Cajamarca in northern Peru, guarded by an army of 80,000 men. Atahualpa is revered as a living god, a son of the sun itself. He's in Cajamarca on a religious retreat, giving thanks for a series of recent military triumphs. When he hears about the progress of the Spaniards, he chooses not to have them killed. Instead, he sends back a message. He invites them to join him in Cajamarca as quickly as possible.
Atahualpa wanted the Spaniards to come to Cajamarca and enter into a trap. And to be sure that they would do so, he played like a psychological game with them, sending presents, asking them to come. Atahualpa knew that the Spaniards were not gods. The intelligence reports speak of people wearing wool on their faces, like a llama, like an alpaca, that is, like an animal. Then they went from one place to the other, wearing on top of their heads a little pot that has never been used for cooking. You need to be crazy to walk with a pot. But you must be beyond salvation if you arrive to a camp and you don't use that pot to cook. Atahualpa had an idea that these were subhumans. What could a few horsemen and 100 and so Spaniards do to the powerful Inca? Virtually nothing.
But Atahualpa's spies don't realize that the Spanish are armed with some of the best weapons in the world. At the time of the conquistadors, Spain had the biggest army in Europe, orchestrated from the imperial capital, Toledo. For more than 700 years, the Spaniards had been at war, fighting against the Moors and other European armies. There was an arms race in Europe. To survive, the Spaniards needed to keep up with the latest in weapons technology.
Hey!
By the 1530s, the harquebus was an important part of the Spanish arsenal. Gunpowder had originally come from China, but its use as a weapon was pioneered by the Arabs. In European hands, guns became lighter and more portable, and were used for the first time by foot soldiers on the battlefield. The harquebus was still a crude weapon, but would go on to change the face of warfare.
To us moderns, this gun doesn't seem useful for anything. It's like a joke. Its aim is terrible, it takes a long time to reload, and while the shooter's reloading, an assortment would come in and kill him. But the Incas hadn't even gotten this far, and even this gun, with its sound and with the smell and with the smoke and with every now and then a person that it manages to kill, would have been terrifying to someone who had never seen this before. This would have been shock and awe, 1532 style.
For all its bluster, the technology of gunpowder was still in its infancy. The real power of the conquistadors lay elsewhere, with the production of steel. Toledo had some of the best swordsmiths in the world. But why were people here able to craft deadly steel weapons, while the Incas were still making simple bronze tools?
There was nothing innately brilliant about Europeans themselves that allowed them to be the ones to make high-quality swords. Just as with guns, swords were the result of a long process of trial and error that began outside Europe. People started working with metal in the Fertile Crescent 7,000 years ago. And because Europe was geographically close to the Fertile Crescent, Europeans inherited this metal technology. But they took this technology on to a new level. European soldiers demanded stronger, longer, sharper swords. This is what a Toledo sword looks like when it's finished. This particular one is modeled on the sword that Pizarro carried. It's a fearsome weapon. It's used for stabbing, and it's also used for slashing, and I can easily understand how the person wielding the sword could kill dozens of people within a short time.
Swords like this, rapiers, represented a high point in a very sophisticated metalworking technology. If you think about what the qualities are that are needed in a sword, first of all, it has to be hard enough, the metal has to be hard enough to take a sharp edge. And that requires steel, that is iron infused with carbon. And the more carbon you put into the iron, then the harder the metal is. But if you make it too hard, then it's brittle. And that's no good, because as you hit somebody, your sword would break. And so you also need your sword to have a certain pliability, an ability to bend and spring back into shape. And it's got, by heating it to certain temperatures, plunging it into cold water, immense amount of experimentation. It took centuries to get to the level of sophistication where you could get something so long and elegant and fine and deadly as the rapier.
The rapier, with its extra long blade, was developed as a dueling weapon, but became so fashionable in Renaissance Europe, it was the sword of choice for any aspiring gentleman.
The word rapier derives from the Spanish term espada ropera, and that means dress sword. And for the first time in Spain, we start to see people wearing the sword with their everyday clothing, their civilian dress, going about their everyday business. They didn't do that in the Middle Ages. This is something new in the 16th century. And it's saying, I have arrived, I am a gentleman, I am upwardly mobile, and I claim ancestry from the knights of the Middle Ages. It was very much a symbol of the conquistadors' aspiring greed. The thing that drove them through all their hardships, the thing that made them go to the Americas, was their lust for gold, their lust for self-advancement. And the rapier absolutely symbolized that overbearing avarice.
On November 15th, 1532, Pizarro's band of adventurers enters the valley of Cajamarca. They've been told that Atahualpa is waiting for them here. But they're not prepared for the sight that greets them. In the hills beyond the town of Cajamarca is the Imperial Inca army, 80,000 men in full battle order. The conquistadors' own journals bear witness to their first impressions.
Their camp looked like a very beautiful city. We'd seen nothing like it in the Indies until then. And it scared us, because we were so few and so deep in this land.
Pizarro sends a party of his best horsemen into the heart of the Inca camp. They are led by Captain De Soto. They are gambling that Atahualpa will allow them to pass through the camp unharmed and agree to meet them.
Soto's visit had a very important psychological purpose: to intimidate the Inca in front of his people, challenging him with the horse. Atahualpa at first didn't react to Soto's presence, as if nobody had entered the room. Once the horse comes eye to eye with the Inca is still calm, showing that the horse has no impact on him, calling Soto's bluff.
The captain advanced so close that the horse's nostrils disturbed the fringe on the Inca's forehead. But the Inca never moved.
And then, after a brief silence, comes Atahualpa's explosion. He was telling them, the time has come for you to pay. I understand this as the time has come for you to pay with your lives. Soto, I understand, was nervous enough to come back with fear to the camp. And as we know, the Spaniards spent the night before in extreme fear.
The conquistadors have made their camp in the town of Cajamarca. Many of them are now convinced they are facing oblivion. 168 soldiers, 1,000 miles from any other Spaniard, facing an army of 80,000 Incas.
Few of us slept that night. We kept watch in the square, from where we could see the campfires of the Indian army. It was a fearful sight, like a brilliantly star-studded night.
Pizarro and his most trusted officers debate their options for how to deal with Atahualpa. Some advise caution, but Pizarro insists their best chance is to launch a surprise attack the next day. It's a tactic that's worked successfully in the past. 12 years before Pizarro went to Peru, another famous conquistador, Hernán Cortés, had gone to Mexico and encountered another formidable civilization, the Aztecs. He conquered the country by kidnapping the Aztec leader and exploiting the ensuing chaos. Cortés's story was later published and became a bestseller, a handbook for any would-be conquistador. It can still be found in the Great Library of Salamanca University in northern Spain.
This wonderful library here can be thought of, among other things, as a repository of dirty tricks, because in these books are the accounts of what generals had been doing to other generals for thousands of years in the past and across much of Eurasia. And here from this library we have a famous account of the conquest of Mexico with all the details of what Cortés did to the Aztecs and what worked. That was a model for Pizarro to give him ideas what exactly to try out on the Incas, whereas the Incas, without writing, had only local knowledge transmitted by oral memory, and they were unsophisticated and naive compared to the Spaniards because of writing.
But if books were so useful, why couldn't the Incas read or write? To develop a new system of writing independently is an extremely complex process, and has happened very rarely in human history. It was first achieved by the Sumerian people of the Fertile Crescent at least 5,000 years ago. They pioneered an elaborate system of symbols called cuneiform, possibly as a way of recording farming transactions. Ever since, almost every other written language of Europe and Asia has copied, adapted, or simply been inspired by the basics of cuneiform. The spread of writing was helped enormously by the invention of paper, ink, and movable type. Innovations that all came from outside Europe
but were seized upon by Europeans in the Middle Ages to produce the ultimate transmitter of knowledge. The printing press. The written word could now spread quickly and accurately across Europe and Asia. The modern world would be impossible without the development of writing. But there's another part of the world where a new system of writing was invented independently. In southern Mexico, at least 2,500 years ago, native people developed a way of working with symbols that evolved into the Mayan script. But if the Maya had writing, why didn't it spread south to the Andes and help the Incas become literate? For Diamond, the answer lies in the shape of the continents.
Here are Europe and Asia forming the continent of Eurasia, a giant continent, but it's stretched out from east to west and narrow from north to south. The American continent is long from north to south, narrow from east to west, very narrow at Panama, where it narrows down to less than 100 miles. The two continents are of the same length, about 8,000 miles in maximum dimensions, but Eurasia is 8,000 miles from east to west, and the Americas are 8,000 miles from north to south. It's as if these continents were rotated 90 degrees of each other.
Diamond has already shown that crops and animals could spread easily east and west across Eurasia. Because places at the same latitude automatically share the same day length and a similar climate and vegetation. But the American continents were the opposite of Eurasia. A journey from one end of the Americas to the other is a journey from north to south. A journey through different day lengths, different climate zones, and dramatically different vegetation. These basic differences hindered the spread of crops and animals, as well as people, ideas, and technologies. The people of the Andes were chronically isolated, without access to writing or almost any other innovation from elsewhere in the Americas. By contrast, Pizarro and his men were geographically blessed. As Spaniards, they enjoyed the benefit of technologies and ideas that had spread easily across Eurasia.
The events of 1532 were clearly influenced by deep causes over which no individual Spaniard or Inca had any control. The shape of the continents, the distribution of plants and animals, the spread of Eurasian technology. These were facts of geography. And at almost every turn of the drama, geography was tilted in favor of Europeans.
It's the morning of November 16th, 1532. Atahualpa has agreed to meet the Spaniards in the town of Cajamarca and sends his entourage ahead of him. But he makes a fateful decision that his soldiers should not carry weapons.
The Indians were musicians and dancers. They were soldiers, but unarmed. Why would Atahualpa unarm his own soldiers? Why? Because he was in the festivity. He was celebrating. He wasn't going to war. He was going for a celebration so that the whole people could see how the alleged gods would run away in fear. The fact that some people believed that the Spaniards were gods would play better in the hands of Atahualpa's purpose. If I know they are not gods and I defeat the gods, then of course everybody will be with me. But what if I defeat the gods with no show of force at all? Then I am beyond the gods.
While Atahualpa and his men enter Cajamarca, the Spaniards are waiting, hidden from view.
There were 5,000 or 6,000 men, and behind them the figure of Atahualpa seated on a very fine litter, lined with feathers and embellished with gold and silver. Many of us pissed ourselves out of sheer terror.
The square is filled with Atahualpa's people, but there's not one Spaniard at sight. Atahualpa asks, "Where are these dogs?" One of his right hands answers, "They have run away because they are afraid of the magnificent Inca." Of course, the whole crowd listened to this and believed that this was the case.
Me presento ante vosotros en nombre de la cristiandad.
Pizarro sends out his priest to confront Atahualpa.
Para enseñaros el camino de la verdad.
The conquistadors are obliged to try and convert native people before any resort to violence.
Pinkanki sun kasapa. Mokakakani intechchuring mi. Mokankani intitaitachchuring. Manang imaparruanay kichu kaipeja.
Mi poder procede de mi señor. Sus palabras están escritas en este libro.
Imankaipi.
Atahualpa has never seen a book before. He doesn't know what to do with it.
Imankai manang imapaschu keka manang rimas kaiki kaipi kanchu.
¿Cómo te atreves, indio perro? ¡Salgan, españoles! ¡Destruyen a estos perros que no respetan las cosas de Dios! ¡Santiago, a ellos!
At that moment, with the crowd absolutely unprepared, horses come. There was massive panic.
Just imagine the scene in Cajamarca. The Incas hadn't seen horses before, and these aren't ordinary horses. These are Spanish horses. Fierce, big, fighting horses. They could get in amongst men. They were trample men, and they made the most excellent platform. From the horse, you could stab down to the left, stab down to the right. You could cut, you could scythe, hacking all about you. If only the Incas had known that what you had to do against cavalry was stand firm, then they'd have been all right. They had superior numbers, but they didn't know that. They fled, they broke ranks, and then the horsemen could get in amongst them, and they cut them down. There was an Inca god called Viracocha, and he was a white man, and he was the god of thunder. And they thought these men with their arquebuses were the very incarnation of Viracocha.
Inca force was in his litter, helped by his carriers. As soon as they were able to do it, the Spaniards went after the litter and they started killing the carriers. One carrier would fall and another one would replace him. Only at the very, very, very end of the tragedy, the litter started to move because there were no more carriers left.
As the litter falls, Pizarro himself captures Atahualpa. His plan has worked to perfection. Atahualpa is taken to a makeshift prison in the royal quarters of Cajamarca.
He thought we were going to kill him, but we told him no. Christians only kill in the heat of the battle.
Outside, thousands of Incas are dead. The rest of the army has retreated to the hills. In spite of a massive imbalance in numbers, Spanish horses, swords, and strategy have proved decisive. But the Spaniards possessed another weapon they didn't even know they had. A weapon of mass destruction that had marched invisibly ahead of them. Today, the war against infectious disease is waged at biological research centers like Porton Down in southern England. They produce vaccines here against the world's deadliest viruses. In the 16th century, there were no vaccines, and there was no protection from the rampant spread of infectious disease. Twelve years before Pizarro arrived at Cajamarca, a Spanish ship sailed to Mexico. On board, one of the slaves was suffering from the first signs of a fever. He was the first person to bring a deadly disease to the American mainland. The disease was smallpox. Within weeks, the smallpox virus would spread from a single source to infect thousands of Native Americans.
Smallpox gets into the body when you breathe in the particles, and they attach themselves to the back of your throat and the inside of your lungs. About 2 to 3 days into the illness, then the classic rash appears. And in its worst forms, this takes over the whole of the body with initially pimples and then enormous blisters until the whole of the skin, starting with the hands and the face and then spreading down to cover the rest of the body, is taken over by the smallpox blisters. From that time on, the patient is highly infectious. Because each of those blisters is packed full of smallpox particles, then if you burst the blister, the fluid will come out and large numbers of viruses will be spilled onto whatever it touches. Ten to 12 days later, his friends would begin to be taken ill. And then 10 to 12 days after that, their friends. That kind of rate means the disease spreads exponentially. Its rate of increase gets bigger and bigger and bigger the more people are infected, until eventually it will cause tremendous devastation in the population.
The first smallpox epidemic of the New World swept through Central America and reached the Inca Empire. Wherever it went, the virus decimated native populations, making them easier prey for Spanish conquest. But why were the germs so one-sided? Why did the Spaniards pass their diseases on to the Incas and not the other way around?
This is Pizarro's secret weapon. Pigs and cows, sheep and goats, domestic animals. Remember that Pizarro was a swine herd. He grew up in huts like this, in intimate contact with domestic animals, breathing in their germs, drinking the germs in their milk, and it was from the germs of domestic animals that the killer diseases of humans evolved. For example, our flu evolved from a disease of pigs transmitted via chickens and ducks. We acquired measles from cattle. We acquired smallpox from domestic animals. So that these worst killers of human people were a legacy of 10,000 years of contact with our beloved domestic animals.
During the Middle Ages, infectious diseases swept through Europe and claimed millions of lives. But paradoxically, repeated epidemics made Europeans more resilient. In each outbreak, there were always some people who were genetically better able to fight off the virus. These people were more likely to survive and have children. In the process, they'd pass on their genetic resistance. Over centuries, whole populations acquired some degree of protection against the spread of diseases like smallpox, a protection the Incas never had.
When smallpox was taken to the New World, nobody in the New World had ever seen a disease like this before, so the number of people who were susceptible was much greater. There was no natural immunity, and so therefore the number of people who could both contract the disease and then spread it, and the number of people to receive it once it had been spread, was much higher. More people would die, and more people would be susceptible to catch it in the first place. It would spread rapidly throughout the population, and the death toll would be enormous.
Why hadn't Native Americans encountered smallpox before? And why didn't they have any deadly diseases of their own to pass on to the Spaniards? It's simply because they didn't have the same history of contact with farm animals. The Incas had llamas, but llamas aren't like European cows and sheep. They're not milked, they're not kept in large herds, and they don't live in barns and huts alongside humans. There was no significant exchange of germs between llamas and people.
The key to Diamond's argument is the distribution of farm animals around the world. Aside from the llama, all the large farm animals were native to Eurasia and North Africa. None was ever domesticated in North America, sub-Saharan Africa, or Australia. As a result, the worst epidemic diseases were also native to Eurasia and North Africa, and were then spread around the world with deadly effect. There's been a long debate about the number of indigenous people who died in the Spanish conquest of the New World. Some scholars think there may have been a population of 20 million Native Americans, and the vast majority, perhaps 95%, were killed by Old World diseases. A continent virtually emptied of its people. After the initial shock of his capture, Atahualpa became a cooperative prisoner. He learned to speak Spanish and play chess with his captors. The Spaniards realized he was more useful to them alive than dead. He was allowed to re-establish his court in prison, as long as he ordered his people to accept Spanish rule. He also ordered them to melt down a vast amount of treasure. Pizarro had promised Atahualpa his freedom in return for the gold. It proved to be an empty promise. Having handed over 20 tons of gold and silver, Atahualpa was no longer useful to his captors.
Infinita misericordia, el último instante, le tendió una mano y lo llevó al reino de los cielos. Ahora, recemos por su
He was garroted to death in the same square where so many of his followers had been slaughtered 8 months earlier. With Atahualpa dead, the conquistadors went on to colonize the rest of Peru, relying on the power of their guns, germs, and steel. Gold from the Spanish colonies was brought back to Seville in southern Spain. There's little activity on the Guadalquivir River today, but in the 16th century, this was among the most important, busiest ports in the world. The steady flow of ships carrying treasure from the Americas helped Spain become one of the richest nations on earth. The conquistadors had changed forever the relationship between old world and new.
I came to Spain to answer a question. Why did Pizarro and his men conquer the Incas instead of the other way around? There's a whole mythology that that conquest and the European expansion in general resulted from Europeans themselves being especially brave or bold or inventive or smart. But the answers turn out to have nothing to do with any personal qualities of Europeans. Yeah, Pizarro and his men were brave, but there were plenty of brave Incas. Instead, Europeans were accidental conquerors. By virtue of their geographic location and history, they were the first people to acquire guns, germs, and steel.
By the end of the 19th century, European powers had ventured beyond the Americas and colonized Africa, Australia, and much of Asia. The process that began at Cajamarca had reached its logical conclusion. European guns, germs, and steel were reshaping the world.